In this lecture, we will be looking at part one of chapter two, water. So here are the learning goals for this chapter. We will learn as to what different kinds of interactions occur between molecules. Why water is a good medium for life. Why nonpolar moieties aggregate in water. How dissolved molecules alter properties of water. How weak acids and bases behave in water. How buffers work and why we need them. How water participates in biochemical reactions. So, we will be learning these goals in various different parts. So, the obvious question is, what makes water so special? And the answer is hydrogen bonding. Water molecules can form hydrogen bonds with other water molecules or with other polar molecules. Hydrogen bonding network of water molecules impose structural restrictions on biomolecules. In addition, water is a critical determinant of the structure and function of proteins, nucleic acids, and membranes. Furthermore, some biological molecules are very insoluble in water, while others are highly soluble. So, we are going to look at all these points one by one. But let's focus first on hydrogen bonding. This chapter, chapter 2, focuses heavily on interactions among molecules. So we will start with small interactions and then we'll build on this on further chapters. If you observe this table carefully, you will see that water has a higher melting point, a higher boiling point, and heat of vaporization than most other common solvents. These unusual properties are a consequence of attractions between adjacent water molecules that give liquid water great internal cohesion. And the reason for that is hydrogen bonding. Let us consider the structure of a water molecule. As you may know, the structure of a water molecule consists of one oxygen atom and two hydrogen atoms attached to the oxygen atom. And from the octet rule, there are four electron pairs around an oxygen atom in water molecule. These electrons are in four sp3 orbitals. Two pairs covalently link two hydrogen atoms, it's one and that's two, to a central oxygen atom. The two remaining pairs remain as non-bonding pairs. So this is a non-bonding electron pair and this is another non-bonding electron pair. So there are two non-bonding electron pairs in this oxygen atom in a water molecule. As a result of it, water molecule has a distorted tetrahedron-like geometry. The electronegativity of the oxygen atom induces a net dipole moment, and that is what is shown as delta plus for hydrogen, both hydrogens, and delta minus towards the electron pair. Because of the dipole moment, water can serve as both a hydrogen bond donor and an acceptor. So water molecule can donate a hydrogen bond and thus a hydrogen bonding. So it's a hydrogen bond donor when it donates this hydrogen or this hydrogen. And it can accept a hydrogen bond via these two electron pairs. Like I said before, the oxygen nucleus in a water molecule attracts electrons more strongly than the hydrogen atoms. That is because oxygen is more electronegative than hydrogens. This means that the shared electrons are more often in the vicinity of the oxygen atom than of the hydrogen. So there are two non-bonding electrons, and also the electron is shared among oxygen and hydrogen, and the shared electron pair is closer to the oxygen. This is the result of the unequal sharing of its electric dipoles, and that is exactly the reason why hydrogens have delta plus and oxygens have a delta minus. As a result, there is an electrostatic attraction between the oxygen atom of one water molecule and the hydrogen atom of the another, as you can see. Now the electron pair attracts the hydrogen from another water molecule, and this is called as a hydrogen bond. And as you can see, a hydrogen bond is about 0.177 nanometers, whereas the covalent bond, that is the OH bond in a water molecule, that is only about 0.06965 nanometers. Now one of the interesting thing about a hydrogen bond is that it is about 10% covalent, this hydrogen bond, due to overlaps in the bonding orbitals, and about 90% electrostatic, whereas this bond is fully covalent. The nearly tetrahedral arrangement of the orbitals about the oxygen atom, as you can see here, allows each water molecule to form hydrogen bonds with as many as four neighboring water molecules, as shown here. The structure, the figure that is shown here, is that of ice. In ice, each water molecule is fixed in space and forms hydrogen bond with a full complement of four other water molecules to yield a regular lattice structure. However, liquid water molecules at room temperature and atmospheric pressure are disorganized and are in continuous motion. As a result, each water molecule can only hydrogen bond with 3.4 other water molecules, whereas ice, as shown here, can hydrogen bond with four other water molecules. As I said before, water can serve as both a hydrogen bond donor or a hydrogen bond acceptor. In this case, this water molecule is a hydrogen bond donor because this is the hydrogen that it donates to this water molecule, which is a hydrogen bond acceptor. It accepts using its lone pairs. Up to four hydrogen bonds per water molecule gives water its anomalously high boiling point or high melting point or its unusually large surface tension. Hydrogen bonds between neighboring molecules are weak. It is about 23 kilojoules per moles. This bond is about 23 kilojoules per moles, whereas the OH covalent bond, this bond is about 470 kilojoules per moles. Water has many different crystal forms. Hexagonal ice is one of the most common of them. Hexagonal ice forms a regular lattice and thus has a very low entropy as compared to liquid water. Hexagonal ice contains more hydrogen bonds per water molecule. Thus, ice has lower density than liquid water and it floats. Hydrogen bonds are not unique to water molecules. Hydrogen bonds are readily formed between an electronegative atom and a hydrogen atom covalently bonded to another electronegative atom. For example, this is a hydrogen that is covalently bonded to an atom, and this can form a hydrogen bond with an oxygen. It can also form a hydrogen bond with a nitrogen. The nitrogen has a lone pair. Again, this hydrogen forms a hydrogen bond with another oxygen. Remember, the difference between this oxygen and this oxygen is that this oxygen is a part of a carbonyl functional group. So, you could also see that a hydrogen attached to a nitrogen, covalently attached to a nitrogen, can also hydrogen bond with another heteroatom, like an oxygen. In a carbonyl in water or in alcohols or to any tertiary amines that has an electron pair. Hydrogen atoms covalently bonded to carbon atoms do not participate in hydrogen bonding. That is because carbon is only slightly more electronegative than hydrogen, and thus CH bonds is only very weakly polar. The distinction explains why butane has a boiling point of only 0.5 degrees centigrade. If you go back to the table that I showed you before, you would see that butane has a boiling point of only minus 0.5 degrees centigrade, whereas butanol has a relatively high boiling point of 117 degrees centigrade. So, this is one of the characteristics of hydrogen bond, and this characteristics can be seen in biological systems. This is a very good slide for your reference when you learn more about biomolecules and interactions among them. And hydrogen bonds are one of the crucial bonds that can help in interactions among biological molecules. For example, as you have seen, water can form hydrogen bond among themselves and with other molecules. For example, alcohols, ROH functionality, or between a ketone or an aldehyde. Now, proteins and polypeptides can also interact among themselves intermolecularly or intramolecularly using hydrogen bonds. And in this case, the NH of backbone of a protein is interacting with a CO of the backbone of another protein or within the same protein. In DNA and RNA, and in this case specifically DNA because it's AT, adenine hydrogen bonds with thymine, right? It's a complementary base pair, and this is one of the fundamental interactions that hold DNA molecules together. The ability of a molecule to hydrogen bond with water is a major component of the solubility of that molecule. The polar nature of water allows it to readily solubilize most charged and some uncharged molecules. For example, sodium chloride or common salt is readily soluble in water. As you may know, sodium chloride is an ionic molecule. It has charged ions, just sodium Na plus and Cl minus. Uncharged molecules such as alcohols, ethanol is a common uncharged molecule that is readily soluble in water, right? Liquor, if you add water, it dissolves in water instantly. If a biomolecule has enough polar groups capable of hydrogen bonding with water, it will be soluble in water. A classic example is sugar, sucrose. Sucrose has enough hydroxyl groups for it to be soluble in water. Hydrogen bonds are strongest when the bonded molecules are oriented to maximize electrostatic interaction, which occurs when the hydrogen atom and the two atoms that share it are in a straight line. That is, when the acceptor atom, this is the acceptor atom, is in line with the covalent bond between the donor atom and the hydrogen. So donor atom, hydrogen, that's a covalent bond. And when the hydrogen bond is in line with the covalent bond, that is when the hydrogen bond is strongest. This arrangement puts the positive charge of the hydrogen ion directly between the two partial negative charges. Hydrogen bonds are thus highly directional and capable of holding two hydrogen bonded molecules or groups in a specific geometric arrangement. Now, this property of hydrogen bonds confers very precise three-dimensional structures on protein and nucleic acid molecules, which have many intramolecular hydrogen bonds. Water dissolves salts such as sodium chloride by hydrating and stabilizing the sodium and chloride ions, thereby weakening the electrostatic interactions between them, and thus counteracting their tendency to associate in a crystalline lattice. As you can see here, the sodium chloride crystal lattice is disrupted as water molecules, as shown here, cluster about the chloride ions and sodium ions. The ionic charges are partially neutralized and the electrostatic attractions necessary for lattice formation are weakened. As I said before, water also readily dissolves charged biomolecules, including compounds with functional groups, such as hydroxyls, in case of sugars, carboxylates with a negative charge, and amines that are protonated, in case of amino acids, and phosphates, in case of phosphatidylcholine and other lipid-like molecules. High dielectric constant reduces attraction between oppositely charged ions in salt crystal. Almost no attraction is found at large distances, that is greater than 40 nanometers. Water is effective in screening the electrostatic interactions between dissolved ions because it has a high dielectric constant. It is a physical property that reflects the number of dipoles in a solvent. The strength or force of ionic interactions is dictated, or it depends on the magnitude of the charges Q1 and Q2, the distance between the charge groups given by R, and the dielectric constant E, which is a dimensionless quantity. Strong electrostatic interactions between the solvated ions and water molecules lower the energy of the system. How does this happen? Entropy increases as ordered crystal lattice is dissolved in water. So as entropy increases, the term T delta S becomes more negative, and as a result, delta G becomes more negative. The molecules of the biologically important gases, such as nitrogen, oxygen, and carbon dioxide, are nonpolar because they do not have a dipole moment. In carbon dioxide, each CO bond is planar, but the two dipoles are oppositely directed and cancel each other. The movement of molecules from the disordered gas phase into aqueous solution can constrain their motion and the motion of water molecules, and therefore represents a decrease in entropy. The nonpolar nature of these gases and the decrease in entropy when they enter solution combine to make them very poorly soluble in water, as you can see from the solubility in water. Right? Whereas some of the gases, such as ammonia and hydrogen sulfide, which has a dipole moment, are polar and are soluble in water. So, one of the main reasons is because of the decrease in entropy and because they do not have a dipole moment. These two contribute to the poorly soluble nature of nonpolar gases.